Now is the time for question time, and I call Mrs. Maxwell.
Thank you. Thank you, President. My constituency question is to the Attorney General representing the Premier. Attorney, the government has announced a number of redress schemes for those who have been harmed by historical actions from state policies and practices. Schemes such as redress for mothers who had their children forcibly removed when born out of wedlock, and reparations for Aboriginal children forcibly removed from their families. In the chamber today are members of the Care Leavers Australasian Network, who continue to campaign for recognition and redress for the physical, psychological and emotional abuse, including child labour practices, they endured in state institutions. They don't begrudge the other redress schemes, but it compounds their trauma when the government won't do the same for them. Why won't the government acknowledge their harm with redress for this abuse?
Leader of the Government.
President, and I thank Ms. Maxwell for her question, and at the outset I also would like to acknowledge the tireless work and advocacy that CLAN do on behalf of those that have experienced abuse in institutional care. It's one of the organisations that we fund to support victims and to provide a range of services to pre-1990 care leavers. The supports include counselling and access to records, drop-in centres, social support groups and the like, and that work is tremendously important. We as a government are very happy to engage with CLAN. I've met with them and I understand that this week both new ministers Kilkenny and Brooks have also meet or are meeting with CLAN in relation to some of these issues. Our government will continue to explore policies and program options to acknowledge and learn from the experience of people from who have experienced harm from institutional abuse and consider ways that we can best support them. Ms. Maxwell has identified, I'm certainly aware of those that are wards of the states who have suffered non-sexual abuse have renewed calls for redress, particularly off the back of the redress schemes that you've identified that the government has recently announced in relation to stolen generations reparations and forced adoptions. We do recognise that trauma takes a range of forms and we'll continue to work with those impacted, as I said. There is the National Minister's Redress Scheme Governance Board, which is currently looking at the federal scheme, which currently covers those that have suffered sexual abuse. That governance board is considering recommendations about eligibility criteria. Minister Rishworth is now the relevant minister. She's also recently announced increased funding for organisations that support victims of sexual abuse from institutional organisations, which is a really welcome investment, around $40 million. I also understand that she is a patron of CLAN, so I'm sure would be very interested in having conversations in relation to the scheme and how it's operating at the federal level, which is the body that is currently the federal government is responsible for this scheme, and obviously the states are all part of that. So there is a lot of work in this space. As I said, I do commend the work of CLAN, and there are ongoing conversations about continued support both at the state level and at the federal level, I'm sure.
Thank you. Ms. Maxwell, on a supplementary.
Thank you, President, and thank you, Attorney. And I have to say that, yes, I wrote to the Honourable Minister Rishworth and had an incredibly prompt reply in relation to this matter. Attorney, there are survivors of sexual abuse in state settings that are unable to access redress or state support because they were placed voluntarily by their parents into state care, and there are few or no records that exist to verify their claim. To assist them in accessing redress for this abuse, will the government lobby the federal government to improve the scheme and find other ways to assess these care leavers who remain invisible and bereft of support?
Leader of the Government.
Thank you, President. I thank Ms. Maxwell for her supplementary question. And as I've indicated in my substantive answer, there is the Governance Board looking at the eligibility criteria, particularly for those that have been subjected to sexual abuse but are having issues in meeting their current eligibility criteria. So more than happy to ensure that those matters that you've raised are on that agenda.
Thank you. Dr. Bart.
Thank you, President. My question is to the Minister for Early Childhood and Pre-Prep. Minister, standalone kindergartens are threatening to opt out of your early childhood programs next year due to what they call the, quote, untenable funding structure. They say their program quality will be stripped back, and one kindergarten, for example, is predicting to run at a $70,000 loss trying to cover senior staff wages and other running costs. How will you prevent kindergartens from closing their doors?
Minister Steed.
Thank you. Thank you, President, and I thank Dr. Bart for his question. And I can think of about 9 billion reasons why I'll be assisting kindergartens in Victoria over the next decade to absolutely thrive. And this is unprecedented investment in the sector and a signal to our kindergartens, including our sessional kindergartens, that our government will invest in them and back in their incredibly important work that they do, setting children in Victoria up for the very best start in life. And Dr. Buck, you would be aware that there has been some there have been funding guidelines issued to the sector in the last week or so. And what that indicates is that the average sessional kindergarten fee structure for parents in Victoria sits at around $1,900 per child per year. The Andrews Labor government will be providing $2,500 per child per year to sessional kindergartens. In the vast majority of cases, this will actually result in increased funding being available for sessional kindergartens, including our community kindergartens. And I must say, as I travel around the state and visit many of these services, they are absolutely wrapped with the support that this will deliver their local communities. It will mean that they will be able to invest in not just providing parents with cost of living relief, and we know how important that is, but also provide additional support and quality kindergarten offerings in their services. It's important to note also, Dr. Buck, that the government already pays a supplement to experienced teachers in our kindergarten system so that kindergartens can continue to employ experienced teachers to lead our programs. And the $2,500 to kindergartens in lieu of parent fees is on top of all of the other funding that is available and will continue to be available. And we will continue to drive these reforms because we know what a difference access to universal kindergarten will make for children, not just in the early years, but for their schooling throughout their life. It'll set them up for a fantastic trajectory for learning, quality education and success in life. So I can also indicate, Dr. Buck, that my department is working closely with a number of kindergarten services to work through some of these issues, including transitional support around our reforms.
Dr. Bartram, the supplementary.
Thank you, President, and I thank the Minister. Minister, you've stated previously that the program that you recently announced was designed, at least in part, to eliminate gap fees. And I thank you for the information you've provided to the House about kindergartens that you say will be better off under this program. There are many kindergartens, however, I'm sure you and other members of the government would admit, who will be worse off under this program. Recently, for example, Katie McNeil from a kindergarten in Glen Iris, along with many others, have made comments about how difficult it will be for them under this program, and specifically about staff in these kindergartens who understand the current offering from the government very well, to pay them due respect, but nonetheless mount the argument that they will be worse off and there's an issue about staff. So what solution will you be offering these kindergartens who will have to replace experienced and senior staff to survive under your funding
model? Time, lucky you managed the question. Minister Steed.
Thank you, President, and I thank Dr. Bark for his supplementary question, which he just got in time there. What I can indicate is that that Dr. Bark is actually sort of conveniently cherry-picking aspects of our reform and our support for both parents and kindergartens. And the reality is that the 98% of sessional kindergartens signed up to our free kinder offering in 2021 when we introduced that year of free kinder. We have taken the considered approach in Victoria to not allow gap fees to be charged, because we want to ensure that this is about parents getting cost of living relief as well as the benefits that will come from their children being in a quality kindergarten program. And I urge Dr. Bark to give me the details of where he says this is not the case, and I'll follow it up with the department.
Thank you. Minister's statement. Minister Singh.
Thank you, President. Well, I would like to talk today about the improvements that are happening in renewable energy across the water sector in Victoria. What we have seen as a consequence of the tireless work of my predecessor, Minister Neville, in the other place, is a statement of obligation which has committed all 18 water corporations across Victoria to achieving 100% of renewable energy across electricity by the 1st of July 2025, and a total net zero emissions by the 1st of July 2035. This is an Australian first, President, and it was a delight to join the extraordinary member for Buninyong again, Michaela Settle from the other place, at the Ballarat South Wastewater Treatment Plant last Friday. It may have been raining, but Central Highlands Water's 6,336 solar panels have certainly been put to good use. As part of this overall commitment to achieving these net zero emissions, we've seen water corporations across the board speed toward achievement of these targets well ahead of schedule. In addition to Central Highlands Water, we've also got Barwon Water's Colac Renewable Organics Network, Yarra Valley Water's Waste to Energy Facility and Wallet, and Wannon Water's 800 kilowatt wind turbine. So despite all of the churn from those opposite, if that were renewable energy, gee, wouldn't you be in luck there as far as leadership aspirations are concerned, then what you would be in a position to see is commitment to our renewable energy target. Not only did you vote it down, but despite that, we're continuing with the work to deliver on our targets and to make sure Victoria leads the way.
Thank you, Mr. Hayes.
Thank you, Mr. President. My question is to the Minister representing the Minister for the Environment. The State of Environment report depicts a catastrophic environmental situation with escalating rates of extinction resulting in the loss of more mammals in Australia than any other continent. The Federal Environment and Water Minister, Tanya Plibersek, said that the State of the Environment report was a shocking document and told a story of crisis and decline in Australia's environment and a decade of government inaction and willful ignorance. I won't be putting my head in the sand, she said. Under Labor, the environment is back on the priority list. Hear, hear. My question is, given a lot of this report includes a shocking depiction of Victoria's current environmental scorecard, will the state government also be getting their heads out of the sand and putting the environment back on the on the priority list?
Thank you, Minister Lean.
Thank you, President, and I thank Mr. Hayes for his question, which is and his passion around the environment, which he shows regularly in this chamber. This is a question for Lily D'Ambrosio, the Minister for Environment. President, I haven't secretly been sworn in as a Minister for Environment as well.
Of course.
Which seems to be the custom practice when of Liberal National governments. So, given that I haven't secretly been sworn in as a Minister of Environment, I will make sure Mr. Hayes' question is delivered to the Minister for Environment and he gets an answer within what's prescribed in the standing orders.
Thank you. Mr. Hayes on a supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. President, and I'm glad to hear Mr. Lean hasn't been secretly sworn in. My supplementary is, ecologists list land clearing as a top cause of wildlife losses, and the State of the Environment report said between 2000 and 2017 there were 7.7 million hectares of land cleared across Australia, and 93% of the vegetation was felled without federal approvals for threatened species habitats. A prime example of this in Victoria relates to the recent approval for Grantville sand mines, where despite populations of vulnerable species listed under the EPBC Act being present on the site, the government granted approval to allow the ripping out of a vital biolink connecting two conservation reserves. This was done without referral to the Commonwealth EPBC Act. Can the minister explain why federal approvals are not sought before clearing land to ensure endangered species are not made extinct?
While I was struggling with the supplementary, but I'll call the minister.
Thank you, President, and thank you, Mr. Hazen. That's a question, a supplementary question, obviously, for the Minister of Environment. I'll make sure that she gets your question and you get your response as prescribed in the standing orders.
Thank you. Ms. Lovell.
Thank you, President, and my question is for the Minister for Water. Minister, in the interest of irrigators in northern Victoria, do you commit to fighting all attempts by Federal Labor to use buybacks to deliver an additional 450 gigalitres of water to South Australia?
Mr. Shin.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Ms. Lovell, for that question. Again, it's actually really useful. It may be belated, but we see an interest from the opposition around water in this state, and better late than never. What I would like to do with the time that I have available is to perhaps inform the House of a range of things that are being undertaken since the former coalition government was voted out after 9 years of inaction. We have seen a preparedness for Minister Plibersek and indeed others to come to the table to talk about the way in which resources can be managed for the benefit of all jurisdictions. One of the things that I note with great relief, as I'm sure others will also do across northern Victoria, is the fact that despite the fact that under the coalition government there was no ministerial council since December 2020, your mates up in Canberra refused to sit around a table.
Order, Minister, order. Mr. Davis, on a point of order.
Very specific question that was asked, and the Minister, on the matter of relevance, the Minister just needs to answer the question. She actually flagged that she was going to make a broader statement on matters she wanted to talk about. She actually just needs to answer the question.
Thank you, thank you. While I understand the question and I understand the Minister, the minute she got up on her feet, there was interjection after interjection after interjection. But I ask the Minister to come back to the question.
Thank you very much, and I look forward to being able to continue to talk without interjections, Ms. Lovell and others. So what we do need to do is to address the pressing issues which are facing basin communities, and as you would be aware, Ms. Lovell, the Murray Basin Plan and indeed the authority and the history of management of water across this part of Australia has been a very long-standing issue, and I also want to confirm that should you not be someone who reads the Weekly Times, I've actually indicated very clearly on a number of occasions that Victoria does not support buybacks or indeed any changes to the positive or neutral socio-economic criteria as they apply under the agreement that was established in 2018. This is where any sorts of changes must deliver a positive or a neutral socio-economic benefit to communities. And in fact, this is where my predecessor, Lisa Neville, worked tirelessly to make sure that Victoria's interests were at every turn front and centre in the development and delivery of water policy and of decision making in often a very hostile negotiating environment, including the absence of any preparedness by former Minister Keith No Minco meetings, Pitt, and now we're in a position to be able to continue to advocate for Victoria's position, including as it relates to our position on buybacks. It's unfortunate you didn't actually know about that position on buybacks already, Ms Lovell.
Ms Lovell on a supplementary.
Thank you, Minister, and I note that you did not give a guarantee that you would fight all attempts by Federal Labor to use buybacks. Minister, the former Minister was quite good on that, but will Minister... Minister, will you guarantee...
Ms Lovell, order. Minister, on point of order.
And its answer and the supplementary. And Ms Lovell is seeking to completely turn around, in fact, completely misrepresent what the Minister just said.
Ms Lovell, order. Thank you for your point of order. Ms Lovell just started. Ms Lovell, your supplementary. Thanks.
Minister, will you guarantee there will be no relaxation of the current operational constraints limits on the transfer of water downstream? And furthermore, Minister, will you legislate the current operational constraints limits to protect Victorian irrigators' entitlements and to prevent the environmental damage increased flows would cause?
Minister Shing.
Thanks, Ms Lovell. What we've just heard in this chamber is your lack of knowledge around the way in which the legislative framework occurs and operates at an interjurisdictional level. What you would know, hopefully, and I look forward to an opportunity to, in fact, assist you to become informed on this, is that the Commonwealth's legislation does not allow any buybacks toward the additional 450 gig. It also doesn't allow from any departure from the positive or neutral socioeconomic criteria, which I've just referred to in answering my supplementary. So I will be, as I've indicated in the answer to my substantive question, I will be reiterating that strongly, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to actually be able to sit around a table with the new Commonwealth Government and with the new Commonwealth Minister. And if the Commonwealth is in fact seeking to scrap that criteria, they should be aware that that was part of an agreement that was struck in 2018.
Thank you, Minister. Mr. Statement, Minister Pulford.
Hello, President. I rise today. In fact, I sort of shuffle across the chamber today to provide an update on a really exciting Australian First initiative that I've recently taken responsibility for, the sick pay guarantee. And of course, I want to acknowledge my wonderful colleague and friend, Minister Ingrid Stitt, for bringing this amazing program to life. Thank you very much, Minister. Now, what I would like to advise the House is that over 5,000 Victorians have now registered for the pilot. The pandemic has highlighted, as we are all aware, more than ever, the flawed nature of insecure work. Our most vulnerable workers were often forced, and indeed still are often forced, to choose between their health or the health of a loved one, or paying rent, or putting food on the table, or paying their bills. The reality is that without sick pay, many people in casual and insecure work will still go to the job sick because they cannot afford to miss a shift, often making themselves sicker and indeed risking the health of others. The sick pay guarantee provides up to 38 hours a year of sick and carers pay to casual and contract workers in certain jobs. It's currently focused on workers in retail and sales, food, trades and food prep, age and disability care, cleaners, laundry workers and security. A couple of weeks ago, I had the pleasure of meeting Ava, who is a casual retail assistant. She is one of the 35,000 Victorians who have registered. She made a claim after, when cooking with an exploding casserole dish, she injured her hand quite badly. Rather than having to stress, in addition to her injury, about money and putting her health further at risk, she was able to take the time off she needed to heal, thanks to the sick pay guarantee, a great outcome for her and for her employer. I'm proud to be part of a government that wants to be doing more to protect our most vulnerable workers. And so my message to all members today and to anybody else watching is if you know anyone who is eligible for the sick pay guarantee, register today. Don't wait until you're sick. Make sure you're covered.
Thank you. Mr. Quilty.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister representing the Minister for Police. The Firearms Act requires security guards to store their firearms at a location belonging to the security company they work for. The Act doesn't provide any mechanism to allow an exception to this, but it seems that LRD have, on their own authority, invented a permit that allows at-home storage for selected security guards. We're told that Senior Sergeant Armstrong has been approving these permits for friends of LRD, former police officers and others with connections. This is part of a broader pattern of LRD acting outside their authority under Senior Sergeant Armstrong, who's been running LRD far longer than VicPol anti-corruption policy allows. To be clear, I think it would be a good reform to allow security guards to take their firearms home, but it's the Parliament's role to make the laws, not LRD. Minister, why are LRD issuing these permits outside their powers under the Firearms Act? LRD appears to wield extraordinary powers with little or no oversight.
Mr. Thiene.
Thank you, President. Again, this is another example of Mr. Quilty making very serious allegations and using parliamentary privilege. The matter will be referred to the Minister for Police.
Mr. Quilty on a supplementary.
Thank you, Minister. We've seen special treatment for clubs with close connections to LRD leadership. Allegations of misconduct and illegal behaviour brought to Armstrong's attention by other officers ignored and swept under the rug. We know that the database has lost track of many thousands of firearms, and many firearms have been misplaced in police custody. We've seen LRD officers sign off on affidavits that attest the missing seized firearms are of no value and were destroyed. We know that almost all complaints to IBAC are referred back to the police, who are expected to investigate themselves. Like the case last week we heard about, where tens of thousands of rounds of ammunition went missing while in police custody. Police investigated themselves and found nothing wrong. Now we have illegal take-home permits issued by LRD. There's evidence, I've seen documents and emails, we've heard witnesses give account after account of misconduct and improper behaviour, but there seems to be no action. Minister, when will we see a real audit and clean-up of the Licensing and Regulation Division?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Again, similar to my response to the substantive, this will be referred to the Minister for Police.
Thank you. Ms. Barth.
Thank you, President. My question is to the Minister for Agriculture. A recent population explosion of feral pig numbers in the northeast of the state around Bonang has seen enormous damage to farmers' pasture and fencing. The owner, one particular property owner, has caught 56 wild pigs this year alone, but there are many, many more, and there is a lack of government control in place. So I ask, Minister, considering the heightened risk of foot and mouth incursion into Victoria, what additional efforts have been put in place to support local farmers manage the feral pig population explosion?
Evening.
Thank you, President. And I actually thank Ms. Barth for this question. It's a very important question, and it's an important question for a whole range of reasons, but particularly in terms of biosecurity, which we all know as a result of foot and mouth in Bali in particular, being close to our borders, has a heightened sense and has, as I said, serious currency in the political will of the country at the moment. So this issue of not just feral pigs but feral animals generally has certainly captured my attention generally as it relates to biosecurity in particular, but also of course in terms of agriculture. So what I have requested as a result of all the other work that is being done is a snapshot on what is actually in place at the moment, what the cross-departmental responsibilities are, because DILP has carriage of certain things and other departments have carriage of others. I'm also seeking more information in respect to the interstatedness, because obviously animals don't take too much notice of borders. I have asked for that and some policy advice so we can have more information to provide the task force with so that we can have a much more up-to-date and holistic attitude and I would dare say development of plans in a more general way to deal with not only pigs, but it's feral cats. It's a whole range of issues that we have in this state and in this country that do carry disease that will potentially have an impact on our agriculture and our environment more generally.
Ms. Barsel, the supplementary.
Thank you. Thank you very much, President, and I thank the Minister for her response and speaking about other feral animals. I'll go to my supplementary, and indeed I heard an interjection from the former minister there about landowners' responsibilities, and this is what relates to this question. With increased risk of FMD and the ability for the disease to be carried by feral animals, a number of farmers are wanting to take preventative action by having an authority to control wildlife permits approved for species like but not confined to hog deer. They are being told by the government that permits will not be pre-approved and to wait for until FMD arrives on our shores, which will be far too late if permits then need to be approved. Minister, given the seriousness of this situation and the need for preventative measures, will the government facilitate the pre-approval of authority to control wildlife permits so farmers can be best prepared for this situation?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Ms. Barth for her question as well. I don't have that sort of level of detail. I would love to, if you could submit the information that you have in relation to landowners in that particular area, to me that would be very, very helpful, but I'll take that on notice if you can also provide me with that information. Thank you. President, it is important to draw attention to the exceptional work being done in the agricultural industry to tackle climate change. Recently, I met wonderful leaders who are at the forefront of the design and implementation of smart, innovative and thoughtful practice to achieve profitable and sustainable carbon neutral farming. Jigsaw Farm on the outskirts of Hamilton is owned by Mark Wooten, Deputy Chair of the Victorian Agriculture and Climate Change Council, and Eve Cantor, co-founder of the Climate Institute. Jigsaw Farm is carbon neutral and renowned for its beef and wool production, as well as leading the way in implementation of sustainable agroforestry. It was a privilege to hear of their strategies and to be taken on a tour of their extraordinary property, from expansive pastures to forests and stunning rejuvenated wetlands. It was so apparent that care for the environment is absolutely consuming. They are committed to ensuring Victorian agriculture is well placed to manage climate risk as well as being productive and profitable. They are a tour de force, and the impact of their work and their philosophies will resonate for generations to come. Similarly, Fiona Conroy and Cam Nicholson of Newleaf Farm on the Bellarine are pioneers in carbon neutral farming. They gave me a great insight into their scientifically proven and very practical measures which have been developed over decades. Jigsaw and Newleaf Farm's commitment to address the challenges of climate change and achieve a productive and profitable farm is critical to our shared futures, President.
Thank you. Dr. Cumming.
Thank you, Mr. President. My question is for the Minister for Housing in the other place. Can the Minister please provide me with the number of people on social housing waiting lists in Western Metropolitan Region by local government area? Now, the Environment and Planning Committee inquiry into the protections within the Victorian planning framework looked at the provisions of affordable housing. In the submission by Maribyrnong City Council, they stated that they are 5,000 applicants on the social housing waiting list in Western Metropolitan Region or Western Melbourne in 2021, including 3,000 applicants waiting under the Priority Access Scheme. Now, the Priority Access Scheme includes people or families identified as homeless or receiving support, escaping family violence, or having a disability. They need the health reasons why.
Mr. Sheen.
Thank you, President. I'm just seeking some clarity about what the question was.
Mr. President, so can the Minister please provide me with the number of people on the social housing waiting list in Western Metropolitan Region by local government area?
Thanks, President. Thanks, Dr. Cumming, for that clarification. In accordance with the standing orders, I will seek a response from the Minister for Housing in the other place and ensure that that gets to you.
Dr. Cumming on a supplementary.
Thank you, Minister. I'd love for them to answer a question. Can the Minister please tell me when this government expects to meet the needs for social housing in the West? Now, the latest Australian Institute of Health and Welfare data has revealed that Only 2.9% of Victorian housing stock is social housing. Their data for 2021 shows a decline in the population of social housing households in Victoria since 2014, from 3.5% of all households to 3.9% in 2021. Of the 80,611 social housing dwellings, 3,818 were considered to be overcrowded. Now, in June, I questioned the Minister, how many first-round grants have been approved to community housing agencies for shovel-ready development in Western Metropolitan region, and I received no response.
Minister.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Dr. Cumming, for that supplementary question. And again, in accordance with the standing orders, I will seek to have a response provided by the Minister for Housing in the other place.
Thank you, Mrs. MacArthur.
Thank you, Mr. President. My question is to Minister for Small Business. Minister, last month you met traders from Elbert Street, Sebastopol, whose businesses have been decimated by the closure of their frontages resulting from the near year-long roadworks in the area. As you know, traders, including a car wash, bakery, cafe and bottle shop and many more, are losing thousands of dollars of revenue each week, in many cases more than 50% of their normal takings. After this meeting, are you still refusing to compensate these business people whose livelihoods have been ruined through no fault of their own, but by your government's inability to competently manage road infrastructure works?
Minister Pulford.
Thank you, President. I thank Ms. MacArthur for her question. The matter that she raises probably goes much more to my responsibilities as a member for Western Victoria than as Minister for Small Business. But in both capacities, I've met now on three occasions with traders that are impacted by the prolonged and extensive roadworks in Sebastopol. Department of Transport Regional Director has been there for two of those three meetings and was represented by one of his colleagues at another, and Juliana Addison, the member for Wenderee as well. What they have, the way that they have been impacted is, in my view, significant, and there are processes and programs, the Department of Transport and Major Roads Projects Authority, obviously not in my portfolio, have at their disposal to support businesses through the challenges associated with the government's big infrastructure agenda. And those things have been subject of those discussions. I've also made sure that each of these businesses is aware of all of the options and support that exists in the small business portfolio as well, in terms of some of the supports that were stood up through the last couple of years to assist people in small business experiencing really quite significant hardship. The position on compensation from the Department of Transport has been clear from the outset, and I know that the Liberal Party have indicated that they would change that. I'm not sure exactly how they intend to change that, but Mrs. MacArthur has indicated to these business owners that there would be a different approach from the Coalition. Our position on this has been consistent and clear. I think that the businesses have, many of them have worked incredibly hard to try and do things differently and to access their customers in different ways, but for some of them that's been very challenging. The roadworks are continuing. The barriers that were most having the greatest impact have now moved from the side of the road to the centre of the road, and so there are those on the southbound side that are now much less impacted than they were, and we look forward to the speediest conclusion of works that's humanly possible.
Mrs. MacArthur on a supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. President. So, Minister, how does a coffee voucher or a car cleaning credit help a business pay bills which run into tens of hundreds of thousands of dollars? And can these coffee vouchers cover rents, rates and utility bills or even a bank loan? Now, these people are suffering severe mental stress, worse than ever than during the COVID lockdowns. So what are you actually doing to get the road fixed faster and the businesses back on track? Because so far, your efforts have been totally unsatisfactory.
Minister.
President, I'm mindful of our standing orders and the fact that I am, and haven't been for some time, the Minister for Roads. So I'll take Ms MacArthur's question on notice in accordance with our standing orders for Minister Carroll to respond to. And Ms MacArthur's not half as silly as she's pretending to be in asking me this question. She knows who the responsible minister is and has done the whole time. Well, I'm one of five members for...
Order. Mr Davis on a point.
On a point of order, this is clearly a supplementary question. It's about precisely the same topic, and it relates to the impact on the businesses. And you are the Minister for Small... It does, actually. It does. It does.
Minister already indicated she will take that on notice, and I have to make it clear to the Minister that will be one day, but I'll let you finish, Minister.
Thank you, President. Look, I mean, the truth is I probably should have taken the first question on notice as well, but I'm conscious of that, that there are some people who are telling these businesses that in spite of their profound challenges that they're already facing, they're telling them untrue things, and I would encourage those people doing that to desist. On the question, the specific question about the
Thank
specific
you,
question
Minister.
About
Minister.
When the roadworks will be finished.
Mrs. MacArthur, on a point of order.
President, on a point of order, I take total exception to that comment, Minister, and I ask you to withdraw it.
The Coalition would provide compensation? Pretty sure it is. So I don't really feel much like withdrawing that.
Thank you. We'll move on. Minister State.
Thank you, President. And last week I had the opportunity to join my Commonwealth and State and Territory colleagues at the Education Ministers' meeting in Canberra. It's refreshing to have a federal government with a shared commitment to early learning and care and a partner in Canberra who's willing to address the challenges and opportunities facing the early childhood sector. With the meeting focusing on the teaching workforce, it was an important opportunity for Victoria to discuss our ambitious reforms that will transform early learning. At the heart of our $9 billion Best Start, Best Life reforms is the workforce. Our teachers and educators who work so hard every day to teach our young children all the skills they'll need for a happy and healthy life. And this meeting was also an opportunity for Victoria to continue to advocate for a shared vision and plan to attract and retain a workforce across the entire early childhood sector, including not only kindergartens but also long daycare. We already have a comprehensive kinder workforce strategy here in Victoria with an investment of $209 million, and we know there's always more work to be done. I'm pleased that Education Ministers agreed to ensure teachers and educators across early childhood settings are valued and supported as education professionals. I look forward to continuing these discussions and important work with Minister Ali and my colleagues across the country.
Thank you. Is that question time?